Is it okay to call out false teachers and false prophets that are trying to preach in Christianity? What are the essential doctrines that we need to focus on, and what are the ones we need to rebuke? Also, would you prefer regular chicken wings or buffalo chicken wings? Those questions are going to be answered today on Theological Discussion.
This is Theological Discussion with the Christian Anarchist.
And this is what the Lord Almighty said, and it's God to justice.
Here we talk about the Bible, apologetics, news relating to the Christian faith, and most of all, proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And now, from Spiritually Honest Ministries, here's your host, the Christian Anarchist.
Each other, do not plot evil against each other. Do not plot evil against each other. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do not love evil.
Hi, welcome, welcome, welcome. Hallelujah. This is the first ever podcast episode of Theological Discussion. I am your host, as usual, the Christian Anarchist. Let's get started on today's episode. All right. So, one of the topics that I wanted to cover would be on the concepts of false teachers and false prophets. This is a concept that's been going on for a while, and it's a really troubling kind of deal, because with false prophets and false teachers, some of them will claim that they speak directly from God, that God speaks directly through them, and that's why you'll have some people, they prefer to have the name instead of reverend or brother or father or all that. They prefer the term prophet and prophetess, because they believe that sometimes the words they say directly from their mouth are the exact words spoken from God, even though they're not from the scriptures. Now, I've seen people that will say a bunch of things. I've seen some will say that the salvation is by a works-based system. You're saved, but in order to guarantee that salvation, to keep it locked, you have to do some good works in order to keep it. There is some that say you need to hold to a particular prophetess or prophet as being true. Well, you know, like Joseph Smith for Mormonism, and whatever the person is for Jehovah's Witnesses, and then whoever the person is for the Seventh-day Adventist. I really don't care at this point. And so that's one concept to keep in mind, to consider. But, of course, the question comes, what does it say about the scriptures? So let us look into the scriptures right now. This is coming to be from the NIV. For some of those that just want to learn the basic English, I prefer King James and NASB. But NIV is a good one that I'm going to use on the show for the modern average speaking American Christian of different denominations, whether you be a Southern Baptist like myself, a Lutheran, a Methodist, or whatnot. We at least need to understand the same common language. So, starting off at 2 Timothy chapter 2, there's some passages dealing with false teachers, which is, if you have an NIV or anything, it'll say dealing with false teachers above the paragraph. And it says this, dealing with false teachers, verse 14, keep reminding God's people of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words. It is of no value and only ruins those who listen. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth. So, whenever we handle the Bible, we have to be considerate of the Bible. We need to be considerate of the words that come from it. So, we need to find out how to fix the problem of quarreling with words, because sometimes people will take words out of context and will use them for their own agendas. So this is how Jehovah's Witnesses believe that if you don't refer to God as Jehovah, you are not calling God by his proper name, and therefore are not following and worshiping the true God. And when we focus and get into details about that, that ruins conversations. Because it says it is of no value and only ruins those who listen. So we need to always keep in mind what the original scriptures are saying, and note that the words were originally written in Hebrew and Greek, and what we have is just merely translations. So when someone takes too much out of it and focuses on things like King James onlyism, that's going to be a problem, and it's going to stir up some controversy. Anyways, but why did the scriptures matter, of course? Well, you know, you say this: all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. This is 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. It's a very famous verse that explicitly defines the authority of the Bible. Now, it says all scriptures God-breathed, but it's useful for rebuking and correcting. This is one of the two things in there, as well as teaching and training in righteousness. So, who is it we rebuke? Well, we always have to keep in mind who we have to rebuke, who we have to deal with, because there are people we are going to meet, and as terrible as it sounds, there's always going to be strifes, and there's always going to be troubles, and there, especially in the brother, in the body of Christ, there will be false teachers and false prophets. Now, there's a, from 1 Timothy, starting at verse 3, and just read along with me if you wish to, and it's where Timothy charged to oppose false teachers, and it says this: as I urged you when I went unto Macedonia, stay there in Ephesus. And Ephesus, of course, is a place where, I forget exactly where it is, but it is a location. But note that there's a key word that follows here: stay there in Ephesus so that you may command certain people not to teach false doctrines any longer, or to devote themselves to the myths and endless genealogy. Such things promote controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith. Okay, so that's verses 3 and 4. So, it's interesting to look at the fact that Timothy is telling people who he's addressing to in the letter to not, he's telling them to stay in Ephesus, or he went to Ephesus. I honestly haven't studied that much of the text, but either way, there's a location being pointed out where these false teachers are, where people are teaching false doctrine. So the myth that we shouldn't call out false teachers and false prophets by name, though names were not mentioned, apparently Timothy was not afraid to say that there was a place where false doctrines was being laid out. And sometimes that's what these letters were written to. They were written to places that were teaching false doctrine, and he was trying to correct them. So when we correct people, we have to show love and compassion. We can't just say, you're an evil heretic, go burn. You know, if we really love each other that much, we need to show the love of Christ and ask, hey, I want you to be with Christ, so allow me to at least correct the doctrine, at least allow me to rebuke and instruct you, because that's me showing you love, that I don't want you to go to hell, and I will let the Lord handle it while I teach his word. So, and then we go on to verse 5. The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. Some have departed from these and have turned to meaningless talk. 7, verse 7. They want to be teachers of the law, but they do not know what they are talking about or what they so confidently affirm. This is when false teachers, they don't know what they're saying. They don't know what they're talking about. They're just spouting out false doctrine, and it's getting them nowhere in life. It's probably going to get them people that are going to convert to a false gospel, and it does the condemnation, but it does nothing in edifying the body of Christ. It promises false things. So, we have to make sure to consider that. In my NIV Bible study, study Bible, there's a note here, and this, of course, will go, if you want to read the full context, go to verses 3 through 11, but here's the deal. It says, in this section, along with chapter 4, verses 1 through 8, verse chapter 6, verse 3 through 5, and 20 through 21, Paul warns against the heretical teachers in the Ephesian church. So, okay, so Ephesus is talking about the Ephesians that is written in the epistles for Ephesians. So, we have that. Alright. And what else is there? I got lost. I'm infallible. They are characterized by teaching false doctrines. That's one. They were building up endless, far-fetched, fictitious stories based on obscure genealogical points. They were being argumentative. They were using talk that was meaningless. They were wanting to be teachers of the Old Testament law. They were being conceited, not knowing what they were talking about, and using their positions of religious leadership for financial gain. These heretics were probably forerunners of the Gnostics. So, this is a good idea of the prosperity gospel preachers that we have being labeled out here. And this is, we just need to be careful when concerning that. Alright, we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we will get into what Jesus had to say about these false teachers and false prophets, how we can know about them, and get into a couple of these false doctrines that we need to understand and refute in this modern age. So until then, this is Praiser going to be playing for our quick break with No Christian Country. Let it rock! That was No Christian Country by Praiser, and this is Theological Discussion, the podcast. I am, of course, your host, the Christian Anarchist. Now, when we last left off, we were... I just think I misstuttered my words there. When we last left off, there we go. We was discussing in the epistles of Timothy... What was going on? Why do we need to be aware of the heresies and the false teachers? We need to rebuke them and keep to the scripture as our holy inspired word. Now, when we are dealing with heretics, we need to, of course, not be rude. We will have to be rude to the doctrines, but to that individual, keep in mind this. Do not just try to burn bridges with the person just because they're teaching something you do not like. We are supposed to be the body of Christ, so do it in a respectful manner, and do it in a sense that you are not going to lead them so far astray that they'll just dive more into that heresy, but rather show the passion, the gentleness, and the light and the peace that comes from the Christian faith. Now, the next thing I wanted to go over was in the Epistle of Titus. Now, for some of those that don't know the background of Titus, I'm trying to see who the author... Yeah, the author was Paul, it seems. And the purpose and occasion for it was that Paul introduced Christianity in Crete when he and a person named Titus visited the island. After which he left Titus there to organize the converts. Paul evidently then sent the letter with Zenas and Apollos, who were on a journey that took them through Crete. You'll see this journey mentioned in chapter 3, verse 13 of this letter. To give Titus personal authorization and guidance in meeting opposition. You'll see this in chapter 1, verse 5, chapter 2, verse 1, verses 7 through 8 of chapter 2, verse 15 as well, and chapter 3, verse 9. Instructions, and there's also given the instructions about faith and conduct and warnings about false teachers. Paul also informed Titus of his future plans for him, which is in chapter 3, verse 12. If you want to check those scriptures out, feel free to do so. But there are false teachers that are being mentioned here, and Titus is being given a personal authorization and guidance in meeting the opposition. So, let us get to the bottom of this. So, here's what I was mentioning earlier was one of the things that Titus was given, chapter 1, verse 5. The reason I left you in Crete, referring to the Apostle Paul talking to Titus, was that you might put in order what was left unfinished, and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. So this is referring to elders, and sometimes they'll also use the term of overseer. Basically, these are the church elders, the church, the people that have somewhat of an authoritative state, the church government, basically, people that take a position in there, rather than be the pastor, or anyone else, for that matter, that has some kind of higher role in the church government compared to just the regular average Joe sitting in the pews. And he goes on to talk in chapter 1, verses 7 through 10. And he's talking about what the overseer is. And also, let's go to verse 6 first, because it continues with the elder, then goes to overseer. An elder must be blameless, faithful to his wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer manages God's household, he must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain. Prosperity gospel preachers, listen to this. Dishonest gain. Now, verse 8. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. So, okay, sound doctrine is being labeled here and mentions, and to refute those who oppose it, it being the sound doctrine. So, the trustworthy message is from Paul telling Titus that he needs to encourage others to follow sound doctrine and to refute those who oppose it. Sounds simple to me. Okay, and then verse 10. For there are many rebellious people full of meaningless talk and deception, especially those of the circumcision group. Now, I mentioned we were going to get into some of these heresies. Let's go ahead, based on the scriptures, go into it. So, sound doctrine. There are essentials and non-essentials. Non-essentials are basically the things that admit we can agree to disagree, but it's only our perception on the Christian religion and not a how-to deal. That's the problem with what people say. They'll try to make a non-essential become an essential. For example, I'm a Southern Baptist. As a Southern Baptist, I may disagree with the concept of infant baptism, but I don't think that people who baptize infants, like Methodists and Presbyterians, are heretics, and I don't think they consider the same thing either. They both say it's a sign of a covenant deal. It's not about salvation. The water doesn't actually save you, but it's a sign of covenant thing, kind of like with the people in the Jewish people, they would be circumcised. And just so you'll know, that's not what he's talking about by the circumcision group. We'll get into it soon, but to clarify, there is a denomination known as the Church of Christ, and a group known as the Duck Dynasty people, otherwise known as the Robertsons, happen to actually be a member of this kind of a denomination and congregation. And they teach, at least a majority of the Church of Christ denominations and what their teachings of statement of faith has said, that you must be baptized physically by the water in order to be saved. And they'll point to things like, well, somebody had to be baptized twice. It says go baptize, so English, modern raised American terms, that means you have to literally go put them in some water and baptize them, and that's how you save them. But that's the problem, is that we're taking the concept of baptism in a dangerous sense, because that's not what it meant by baptize in some of these passages. When Jesus says in Matthew 28, verses 19 to go baptize everyone in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, he is talking about baptizing in the Holy Spirit. Because remember, John the Baptist said that he came to baptize with water, but there is one who will come that's even greater than him, who will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire, or the Holy Ghost and fire, depending on what translation you have at the time. And it's just, it needs to be considered, really, that baptism is not just about water. I don't know what the term baptism means in general, but I'm pretty sure it's not just referring to the concept of water. You can look it up in the Greek. Unfortunately, I don't have my lexicon on me right now or my computer open, and I'm not going to bother doing so, because I am going to need to get through the show and just going to read the scriptures, because that's all I need to do for now. Now, but the circumcision group that was mentioned here in verse 10, this, according to the footnotes in the study Bible, these are the people that are mentioned in, let me check, they believe it's Galatians chapter 2, verse 12. So, let us get that going. Okay. Alright. Can't find it. Okay. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. Alright. Now, who is the circumcision group? Let us find out. Okay. Says they were Judaizers who believed that circumcision was necessary for salvation. So these were Jewish Christians, Messianic Jews. And they believed that for salvation and sanctification, or it could be one or either, depends, it was necessary to be circumcised. And of course, you have to keep the Jewish ceremonial law. This is later referred to as Jewish myth, because this is something that's not considered from God. This is not a teaching from the Christian scriptures. Though we have it in Old Testament law, most of those were covenantal laws given only to Moses and his people, and people kept to the traditions, which, that's the thing, they just kept to a tradition instead of following what God would say to them, what God says. And the problem with tradition is that it can lead to some very bad distortions over practices and teachings in the Bible. And I've met someone that said that, you know, we need to be baptized in order to be saved. I'm like, why? He's like, because the Bible says so. I'm like, well, understand what it means by baptism. Sure, they baptize with water, but that's after they profess and to be believing Christians. That's after there has been another baptism that's went on already, and the Lord baptizes with the Holy Spirit, and that's when he fills you with the Holy Spirit, gives you a new spirit, gives you a new heart, and renews your mind, and you have been conformed to the body of Christ. You've been conformed very well with what God wants for his children. So, you have that being mentioned. And just like people who try to add things onto salvation, like circumcision people do, Jehovah Witnesses saying you gotta talk about Jehovah, do not say anything else but Jehovah. To me, the concept seems kind of ridiculous when someone would add on to the salvation. Like, some people even say, oh, you have to read a specific version of the Bible, or you have to read the entire Bible to be saved, or you have to, not have divorces. Oh, you have to be abstinent the entire time. Oh, when you're a priest, you have to guarantee that you don't have sex, or you don't get in a relationship, or you don't get married. Okay, I can understand the priest part if you're probably doing just political church office deal and you're just trying to, you know, at least maintain as a good role model. I mean, sure. But to add that as a salvation thing, that the priest does that, then he automatically loses his salvation, is nonsense. Absolute nonsense. You will not find that in the scriptures. Absolutely will not. Now, concerning that, some people will say, yes, you have to not sin because that's what the Bible teaches. Well, the Bible doesn't teach. The Bible teaches we should repent of sins. We have to have a different perspective on it. But the one thing that we will know from the Bible is that everyone sins, and even whether we're aware of it or not. Now, the Apostle Paul in his letter to Romans, let me find the exact passage. He's talking about how he is struggling with sin, starting at verse 14 in chapter 7. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know what good itself does. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. And he concludes a little bit in verse 21. So I find this law at work, although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. Verse 22, for in my inner being I delight in God's law. Hallelujah. Praise God for the Apostle Paul and that preaching that he was writing into Romans chapter 7. So we have a sinful nature. We have the desire to sin. We want sin. Well, our bodies do anyways, but our consciousness, we do not want it, even though we act upon it. And that's the thing that separates the believer from the non-believer, is that we recognize the wrong, the sin, and we repent of it. Well, others will love their sin. They will love the fact that they had got into a very big sin of case of lust. They would love the fact that, or they would not repent of the fact that someone would hate somebody. Like that person hates somebody, said, oh, I hate you, and you deserve to be hated. La da 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 da. Or even wish ill harm. They will not repent of that or feel bad about it. I say things and I feel bad about it. I've done things before and that I felt bad about. It's always about your attitude towards it. You will probably act upon that sin. The best thing you can do is try your best to prevent it from happening in the future. But even though you fail, failure does not keep you out of God. God will keep who he wants, and if you are the one who has that desire to be with him, God will keep you because he has shown you him already. And if you desire God, that means he's already revealed himself to you and he's wanting you to stay with him. And that's where the desire and the hunger for God comes to show its power, its great glorious power. Now, speaking of great power and glory, let's get to Jesus. We can't have a Christian thing without talking about Jesus. Am I right? All right. Now, Matthew chapter 7 is the last chapter of which started originally at verse 5, I mean chapter 5, with Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And he's getting a lot of different topics, but the one topic he gets at starting at verse 15 and then ends at 20 is the false prophets, the true and the false prophets. And it goes something like this: watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes, or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. What does that tell you right there? Anyways, verse 20. Thus, by their fruit you will recognize them. So, we have the actions that we will recognize them by. The fruit is, because Jesus says he's the vine, and we are the fruit. And if we get the fruit, we will, of course, show the works of our faith in Jesus Christ. This has been the episode of Theological Discussion for the podcast. I thank everyone for watching, and hopefully you'll come in and tune in for the next show. So until then, we're going to end in prayer, and let us hope this was an edifying case. So let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for all that you've given us. We thank you for this podcast, this discussion. We hope that it edifies and people will meditate on what was said. We cling to your word, God, as the infallible, inspired word of God. You are very glorious and very great, God. We thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for us. We ask that you bring healing and bring good things to everyone according to your will, Father God. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Alright, that's enough from me. Time for me to head on out. And now, I will leave you with this, the usual Shalom Aleichem. May peace be upon you, because I wish that upon you. Have a good day.